Hi again. In this third video, in this little mini-series on marks adjustment processes, we're going to talk about scaling. Remember, we're looking at lots of different contexts that people achieve their performance in, and we're trying to make sure that we compensate for those different contexts so that the comparison that we make between people's performance is as fair as it can be. And in this process, we're looking particularly at the difference between courses. And the process that does that is called scaling, also known as the process everybody loves to hate. So everyone complains about scaling, and I get that, but it is actually sort of necessary. So let's explain why that's the case. Scaling is about comparing someone's performance in the context of who they're competing against in a particular subject. It's not actually about whether a subject itself is easy or hard per se. The scaling process actually looks at who you're competing against in a particular subject. And in the previous overview video, I use the example of sports, and we do this all the time. If you came first in your school athletic carnival compared to coming, say, fifth or sixth in the Olympic 100 metre final, I wonder whether you'd how you'd weigh up those two levels of performance. And we generally agreed that performance in the Olympic 100 metre final, even if you did come sixth instead of first, is probably still a higher level of performance than the school athletic carnival because of the greater intensity of the competition at that level. And it's a little bit the same in the subjects that you do in your ways. So some subjects tend to attract people who are very high achieving students across the board, and other subjects have a much wider range of people doing them, and so the level of competition isn't as high. So how do we work out the level of competition? Well, the process is called average marks scaling because that's exactly what happens. What we do is, for every person who takes a particular subject, and in this example we've just got two subjects that we're looking at rather than the 50 odd that we do in the actual process, and what the process does, we'll look at everyone who takes course A and thinks, okay, how well do they do in their other subjects? Because that's the best measure that we've got of how academically capable they are. And this will do the same for all the people who take course B as well. It will look at all the other subjects in all the combinations and then produce an average for all of the performance of all the people in course A, and we'll compare that to the performance across the board of all the people who take course B. And in this example, you can see that the average that comes out of the course A people's performance is 58.5, whereas in course B, the average across the board is 65.8. So from that, the average mark scaling process would say, okay, well, the competition in course B is a little bit more intense than it is in course A, because the people in course B have achieved higher marks across the board, so it's a slightly more academically capable group of students doing course B. And then the scaling process in response to that will actually adjust the marks in course B upwards slightly so that the average for course B will end up being 65.8 as well. And for course A, the average will go down slightly to 58.5 so that it matches the average across the board. Some people think that the scaling parameters are predetermined before we even start because they look at courses like physics and chemistry and literature and things like that, and they'll see that those courses tend to have an average scaled mark that's very similar from year to year. Now, that's not because we have decided that that will happen in advance. None of these calculations are done in advance. They always depend each year on how well that particular group of students do for that year. So the reason why big subjects tend to have very similar kinds of averages from year to year is that they tend to be taken by people of similar ability levels. And because we're dealing in such large numbers, the averages tend to be fairly stable. So remember that the only reason we do that is to form your tertiary entrance aggregate and then to form your ATAR. Well, I hope you found that helpful, and all the best for the rest of the year.